You're listening to the Intrepid radio program with Scotty Roberts. Intelligent talk.
It's Friday. Last night was not Friday, it was Thursday. All day yesterday, I thought it was Friday, and so that's why I said Happy Friday yesterday and closed off with, see ya on Sunday morning, have a nice weekend. Well, that kind of shows you what happens around here during this whole shut-in, self-isolating, sequestration, quarantine period. Sometimes we lose track of the days. I could have sworn yesterday was Friday. But folks, this is Scotty Roberts, and I'm here to tell you today that today is Friday. So happy Friday. Welcome to my show, the Intrepid Radio Program, right here on the Odyssey Radio Network. That's odysy1.com. And you can go over there and check out all the places where you can hear this show in its audio format, all the different outlets to pick it up. And you can also come on over to my YouTube channel to see this show in its live simulcast in video over at youtube.com/Mr. Scotty Roberts. And come on over and join all the other intrepids who are already starting to chat up a storm over there. And they talk about things about the show and things that are way off topic from the show. And they've all gotten to know each other pretty well. Come on over and join them. Join all of us. And have a good time. Now, yesterday, all this week, we've actually been talking about King Solomon. Not so much from a historical standpoint of verifying his historicity, his place in history. I do believe he was an actual historical person. And we did talk about him at great length when I was talking about King David in that series I did almost a year ago now. And you can find that archived over on my YouTube page. And he is a character that is enigmatic only because he is mentioned in the pages of biblical writ. And he is a faith character, but also a real-life character from the mid-10th century BCE. On another day, we'll talk about him in more historical fervor. And we'll set some boundaries and we'll set up some historical information that will help you understand this man as an historical character as well. But today, I want to continue what I started yesterday. We talk about Solomon. We talk about his greatness. We talk about him in a biblical context. We talk about him as the king of Israel. And we talk about all these great, glorious, wonderful theological things about Solomon, yet we forget the kind of man he was. And even when we talk about all the darkness and all the things that he tried and tested, the things that were the mystical elements of him that have been obviously embellished over the years, I think it's good to get down to the core of who he really was. And what we started for a good deal of the second portion of yesterday's show, I'm going to continue today until I think we may finish it. I want to continue reading his book, Ecclesiastes, which is a small book, but it gives you an insight into the heart of the man. What was he really made of? He keeps talking about how everything's meaningless. Everything's empty. Everything is like dust in the wind. And I want to pick up where we left off. We got all the way up to chapter 5 yesterday and ended with that. So I'm going to start at the beginning of chapter 5 again. And let's carry it through. There are 12 chapters in all in this small book of his. And they're small chapters. So I think we can accomplish that. And before I do, I'm going to take a sip of coffee out of my Intrepid Radio mug. Now, you can get one of these. Now, this one, I'm going to tell you something, folks. I ordered this one, and it's a little dark. So, I have reset the artwork and set it back up So if you haven't gotten your mug yet, get it now. It's got the artwork that's a little lightened. You can see more of the blues and the stars and the things in the background. But what it's got on here is the phrase that we originally attached with Intrepid magazine, which I when I launched it, which is boldly going. And then the rocket ship, of course, that I designed for Intrepid magazine back in 2010 and 11, something in there. And so you can get your coffee mug. Mine is full of hot, steaming Joe right now. Or as Joe Souchere would say from one of the local radio shows, all I want is a lousy cup of coffee. And that's what this holds. Of course, you can put other things in it, too. I have. Well, my old Intrepid mug, which broke. Now I've got the new one. So go get yours over at my Etsy page. Etsy.com/shop/sonofapatriot. That's my site. And you can see all the other things we do over there as well. So let me take a sip of coffee. Still steaming hot. Gets those vocal cords warmed up. And so let's dig in a little bit more into Ecclesiastes. And I may stop and do a little commentary on some of these passages as we go. But I think it's good for us all to listen to this and to see what this guy was all about and what he was like. Now, he starts chapter 5, which of course the chapter divisions were given much later. He says, "Guard your steps when you go to the house of God. Go near to listen rather than to offer the sacrifice of fools who do not know that they do wrong." Then he lapses into a bit of poetry. "Do not be quick with your mouth. Do not be hasty in your heart to utter anything before God. God is in heaven, and you're on earth, so let your words be few. A dream comes when there are many cares and when words mark the speech of a fool." I'm not sure what he means by "a dream comes when there are many cares and many words mark the speech of a fool." I think he's got two separate thoughts there. A dream comes when there are many cares. My wife's been having a lot of dreams lately. Weird dreams, odd dreams. And she's not quite sure what they mean. She sometimes has these, what's the word? Not preemptive dreams, the precognitive dreams. And some of the things she's dreaming, she's been dreaming about local high schools with gun problems. She dreamt about something else that was similar to that. So a dream comes when there are many cares, says Solomon. Is your heart full of cares, he's asking. "When you make a vow to God," he says, "do not delay to fulfill it. He has no pleasure in fools. Fulfill your vow. It's better to not make a vow than to make one and not fulfill it. Don't let your mouth lead you into sin, and don't protest to the temple messenger, 'My vow was a mistake.' Why should God be angry at you when you say and destroy the work of your hands? Much dreaming and many words are meaningless. Therefore, fear God." And now this is where we start new today. He says, "If you see the poor oppressed in a district and justice and rights denied, don't be surprised at such things. For one official is eyed by the higher one, and over them both are others higher still. The increase from the land is taken by all. The king himself profits from the fields," even though he doesn't work them, is the unspoken there. "Whoever loves money never has enough. Whoever loves wealth is never satisfied with their income. This too is meaningless. As goods increase, so do those who consume them. And what benefit are they to the owners except to feast their eyes on them? The sleep of a laborer is sweet, whether they eat little or much. But as for the rich, their abundance permits them no sleep. I've seen a grievous evil under the sun. Wealth hoarded to the harm of its owners, or wealth lost to some misfortune, so that when they have children there's nothing left for them to inherit. Everyone comes naked from their mother's womb, and as everyone comes, so they depart. They take nothing from their toil, and they can carry that they can carry in their hands. This too is a grievous evil. As everyone comes, so they depart. And what do they gain since they toil for the wind? All their days they eat in darkness with great frustration, affliction, and anger. This is what I've observed to be good, that it is appropriate for a person to eat, to drink, and to find satisfaction in their toilsome labor under the sun during the few days of life God has given them. For this is their lot. Moreover, when God gives someone wealth and possessions, and the ability to enjoy them, to accept their lot and be happy in their toil, this is a gift of God. They seldom reflect on the days of their life, because God keeps them occupied with gladness of heart. Then on to chapter 6. I have seen another evil under the sun, and it weighs heavily on mankind. God gives some people wealth, possessions, and honor, so that they lack nothing their hearts desire. But God does not grant them the ability to enjoy them, and strangers enjoy them instead. This is meaningless, a grievous evil. A man may have 100 children and live many years, yet no matter how long he lives, if he cannot enjoy his prosperity and does not receive proper burial, I say that a stillborn child is better off than he. It comes without meaning. It departs in darkness, and in darkness its name is shrouded. Though it never saw the sun or knew anything, it has more rest than does that man. Even if he lives 1,000 years twice over, but fails to enjoy his prosperity, do not all go to the same place? Everyone's toil is for their mouth, yet their appetite is never satisfied. What advantage have the wise over fools? What do the poor gain by knowing how to conduct themselves before others? Better what the eye sees than the roving of the appetite. This too is meaningless, a chasing after the wind. There's that theme that's set through this whole book. Whatever exists has already been named, and what humanity is has been known. No one can contend with someone who is stronger. The more the words, the less the meaning. And how does that profit anyone? For who knows what is good for a person in life during the few and meaningless days they pass through like a shadow? Who can tell them what will happen under the sun after they're gone? On to chapter 7. A good name is better than fine perfume, and the day of death better than the day of birth. It is better to go to a house of mourning than to go to a house of feasting, for death is the destiny of everyone. The living should take this to heart. Frustration is better than laughter, because a sad face is good for the heart. The heart of the wise is in the house of mourning, but the heart of fools is in the house of pleasure. It's better to heed the rebuke of a wise person than to listen to the songs of fools. You catch that? What a profound verse. It is better to heed the rebuke of a wise person than to listen to the songs of fools. Like the crackling of thorns under the pot, so is the laughter of fools. This too is meaningless. Extortion turns a wise person into a fool, and a bribe corrupts the heart. The end of a matter is better than its beginning, and the patience is better than pride. Don't be quickly provoked in your spirit, for anger resides in the lap of fools. Apply that to all the triggering we see nowadays about politics, about pandemic, about talking with anybody from a different point of view. Don't be quickly provoked in your spirit, for anger resides in the lap of fools. Don't say, "Why were the old days better than these?" For it's not wise to ask such questions. Past is in the past, he's saying. Wisdom, like an inheritance, is a good thing and benefits those who see the sun. wisdom is a shelter, as money is a shelter. But the advantage of knowledge is this: wisdom preserves those who have it. Consider what God has done. Who can straighten what he's made crooked? When times are good, be happy. But when times are bad, consider this: God has made the one as well as the other. Therefore, no one can discover anything about their future. Is in this meaningless of life of mine, I have seen both of these, the righteous perishing in their righteousness, and the wicked living long in their wickedness. Don't be over-righteous, neither be over-wise. Why destroy yourself with these things? Do not be over-wicked, and do not be a fool. Why die before your time? It's good to grasp the one and not let go of the other. Whoever fears God will avoid all extremes. Wow, is that profound? He's saying if you're wicked, just hang on to it. If you're good, don't take it to the nth degree. Whoever fears God avoids extremes. Wisdom makes one wise person, more powerful than 10 rulers in a city. Indeed, there's no one on earth who is righteous, no one who does what is right and never sins. Do not pay attention to every word people say, or you may hear your servant cursing you, for you know in your heart that many times you yourself have cursed others. I see that all the time. I can't believe what he said or she said or so on and so forth, when we know very well we all do that. All this I tested by wisdom and said, I am determined to be wise. But this was beyond me. Whatever exists is far off and most profound. Who can discover it? So I turned my mind to understand, to investigate and to search out wisdom and the scheme of things and to understand the stupidity of wickedness and the madness of folly. If you want to mark this down, this chapter, Ecclesiastes 7, he says, Ecclesiastes 7, verse 23 through 25, let me repeat that. All this I tested by wisdom and said, I am determined to be wise, but this was beyond me. Whatever exists is far off and most profound. Who can discover it? So I turned my mind to understand, to investigate, to search out wisdom in the scheme of things, and to understand the stupidity of wickedness and the madness of folly. That should be a goal for all of us. I find more bitter than death the woman who is a snare, whose heart is a trap, and whose hands are chains. The man who pleases God will escape her, but the sinner, she will ensnare. And I don't think he's talking about just a woman alone. That could be interchanged for genders or sex. He's talking about the concept here. Look, says the teacher, this is what I've discovered. Adding one thing to another to discover the theme of things, while I was still searching, but not finding, I found one upright man among a thousand, but not one upright woman among them all. This only have I found. God created mankind upright, but they've gone in search of many schemes. I'm not quite sure what he's getting at. I don't think he's misogynistic. I think, of course, remember, this is a guy who had 700 wives, or was it 300 wives and 700 concubines. Did he know women? Who knows? But he says, I found one upright man among a thousand, but not one upright woman among them all. This only have I found. Is he's decrying the meaningless, I think, of his life and his searching. And he says, God created mankind upright. Humanity is good, he says, not evil. But they've gone in search of many schemes. Who is like the wise? Who knows the explanation of things? A person's wisdom brightens their face, and changes its hard appearance. Now we're into chapter 8. This is about obeying the king. He says, "Obey the king's command, I say, because you took an oath before God. Don't be in a hurry to leave the king's presence. Don't stand up for a bad cause, for he'll do whatever he pleases. Since a king's word is supreme, who can say to him, 'What are you doing?' Whoever obeys his command will come to no harm, and the wise heart will know the proper time and procedure, for there is a proper time and procedure for every matter, though a person might be weighed down by misery. Since no one knows the future, who can tell someone else what's to come? And as no one has the power over the wind to contain it, so no one has the power over the time of their death. And no one is discharged in time of war, so wickedness will not release those who practice it. All this I saw as I applied my mind to everything done under the sun. There is a time when a man lords it over others to his own hurt. Then, too, I saw the wicked buried, those who used to come and go from the holy place and receive praise in the city where they did this. This, too, is meaningless. When the sentence for a crime is not quickly carried out, people's hearts are filled with schemes to do wrong. Although a wicked person who commits 100 crimes might live a long time, I know that it will go better with those who fear God, who are reverent before him. Yet because the wicked don't fear God, it will not go well with them, and their days will not lengthen like a shadow." There is something else meaningless that occurs on earth. The righteous who get what the wicked deserve. There, let me start that over. There is something else meaningless that occurs on earth. The righteous who get what the wicked deserve, and the wicked who get what the righteous deserve. This too, I say, is meaningless. So I commend the enjoyment of life, because there's nothing better for a person under the sun than to eat, drink, and be glad. Then joy will accompany them in their toil all their days of the life God has given them under the sun. Be happy, he's saying, with what you have. When I applied my mind to know wisdom and to observe the labor that is done on earth, people getting no sleep day or night, then I saw all that God has done. No one can comprehend what goes on under the sun. Despite all their efforts to search it out, no one can discover its meaning. Even if the wise claim they know, they cannot really comprehend it. Chapter 9. So I reflected on all this and concluded that the righteous and the wise and what they do are in God's hands. But no one knows whether love or hate awaits them. All share a common destiny, the righteous and the wicked, the good and the bad, the clean and the unclean, those who offer sacrifices and those who do not. All as it is with the good, so with the sinful. As it is with those who take oaths, so with those who are afraid to take them. This is the evil in everything that happens under the sun. The same destiny overtakes all. The hearts of people, moreover, are full of evil, and there's madness in their hearts while they live, and afterward they join the dead. Anyone who is among the living has hope. Even a live dog is better than a dead lion. For the living know that they will die, but the dead know nothing. They have no further reward, and even their name is forgotten. Their love, their hate, and their jealousy have long since vanished. Never again will they have a part in anything that happens under the sun. We got to go out for break. We're going to be back and read more of Ecclesiastes. Sit tight. We'll be right back. right, gang, we're back from that break. Thanks for sitting tight. This is Scotty Roberts. You're listening to the Intrepid Radio Program right here on the Odyssey Radio Network. That's odysy1.com. Go check them out. And also come and watch the YouTube simulcast, the video with the live chat room over at my YouTube channel. That's youtube.com/Mr. Scotty Roberts. We're talking about Solomon tonight as we sip from our, or I sip from my Intrepid mug, which you can get over on my Etsy page. And Audrey or someone will post that up, or I'll type it into the chat room. And come and get your mug. It's good. Holds coffee and other good things. And Solomon, with all the mysticism around him, with all the history about him, we're kind of skipping that and looking at the real man. The man who wrote. And he's very fatalistic and a bit of a downer in this book, if you will, to just put some crass vernacular on it. Because he's looking at life and he's evaluating it from his position as an old man after having lived this wonderful life, the king of Israel, not having any want or desire, being filthy, wildly wealthy, living in a time of peace and prosperity, great wisdom, great discovery for him. He spent, imagine being so wealthy that you have to carry out your officious duties, but at the same time you had all that time of peace and wealth to explore everything you wanted to explore. And this is what he did. And this book is the result of all of that. We ended in the last segment where he said, as it is with the good, so with the sinful. As it is with those who take oaths, so with those who are afraid to take them. This is the evil in everything that happens under the sun. The same destiny overtakes all. The hearts of people, moreover, are full of evil, and there's madness in their hearts while they live, and afterward they join the dead. And anyone who's among the living has hope. Even a live dog is better than a dead lion. Look at what he's saying here. He's not talking about this glorious afterlife. He's talking about life as we know it. Because even he, for all he says he believed, didn't really know what was coming next. And he was saying, none of us is going to know the future. It's like when I do a reading for people and I say, this card is the near future or the outcome. And this is the direction you're heading, is what the energies are telling you. But it's not cast in stone, because the future is mutable. It's changeable by what we do. This is what he's saying here about knowing the future. And he says, for the living know that they will die, but the dead know nothing. They have no further reward, and even their name is forgotten. Their love, their hate, and their jealousy have long since vanished. Never again will they have a part in anything that happens under the sun. Go eat your food with gladness, and drink your wine with a joyful heart, for God has already approved what you do. Always be clothed in white, and always anoint your head with oil. Enjoy life with your wife, whom you love, all the days of this meaningless life that God has given you under the sun. Go enjoy your meaningless life, he's saying. All your meaningless days. For this is your lot in life, and in your toilsome labor under the sun, whatever your hand finds to do, do it with all your might. For in the realm of the dead, where you're going, there is neither working, nor planning, nor knowledge, nor wisdom. I have seen something else under the sun. The race is not to the swift, or the battle to the strong, nor does food come to the wise, or wealth to the brilliant, or favor to the learned, but time and chance happen to them all. Moreover, no one knows when their hour will come. As fish are caught in a cruel net, or birds are taken in a snare, so people are trapped by evil times that fall unexpectedly upon them. I also saw under the sun this example of wisdom that greatly impressed me. There was once a small city with only a few people in it, and a powerful king came against it, surrounded it, and built huge siege works against it. Now there lived in that city a poor man, but wise. And he saved the city by his wisdom, but nobody remembered that poor man. So I said, Wisdom is better than strength. But the poor man's wisdom is despised, and his words are no longer heeded. The quiet words of the wise are more to be heeded than the shouts of a ruler of fools. Wisdom is better than weapons of war, but one sinner can destroy much good. On to chapter 10. As dead flies give perfume a bad smell, so a little folly outweighs wisdom and honor. The heart of the wise inclines to the right, but the heart of the fool to the left. Is that a political statement? Probably not. He's just using the opposing directions as an example. Even as fools walk along the road, they lack sense and show everyone how stupid they are. If a ruler's anger rises against you, don't leave your post. Calmness can lay great offenses to rest. Get that, folks? Calmness can lay great offenses to rest. I have always said, you cannot offend me. Why? Because offense is a choice. Being offended is a choice. If, I'm so offended at what you said. We're offended because we choose to let those words offered to us harm us or hurt us or offend our sensibilities. If you choose to not let those things happen, you cannot be offended. Calmness can lay great offenses to rest. There is an evil I have seen under the sun, the sort of error that arises from a ruler. Fools are put in many high positions, while the rich occupy the low ones. I have seen slaves on horseback, while princes go on foot like slaves. We talked about that verse the other day. Whoever digs a pit may fall into it. Whoever breaks through a wall may be bitten by a snake. Whoever quarries stones may be injured by them. Whoever splits a log may be endangered by it. If the axe is dull and its edge unsharpened, more strength is needed. But skill is going to bring success. If a snake bites before it's charmed, the charmer receives no fee. Words from the mouth of the wise are gracious, but fools are consumed by their own lips. At the beginning, their words are folly. At the end, they are wicked madness. And fools multiply words. There is so much stuff in these words that Solomon wrote. You could take, as when I was a pastor, I wasn't a pastor of a church, I was a youth pastor, but in ministry, if I wanted to do a series of sermons on the book of Ecclesiastes, it would take me 2 years to get through all the material because I could take any one of these phrases, sentences, in their context, and divide them into an hour worth of talking. Well, for the sake of my audience, I would say 20 to 25 minutes. But this is chock full of information. Pick up a Bible, an Old Testament, and read the book of Ecclesiastes for yourself. I'm reading, by the way, from the New International Version, which takes the Old English of the 1611. It's gone back further to the texts that we have available and interpreted more in modern idiom, modern language. That's all this is. That's why it sounds so readable. You read it in the King James English, it's going to be a little tougher to comprehend some of this stuff. So he says at the beginning, the words of the fools are folly. At the end, they are wicked madness. And fools multiply words. No one knows what's coming. Who can tell someone else what will happen after them? The toil of fools wearies them. They do not know the way to town. Woe to the land whose king was a servant and whose princes feast in the morning. Blessed is the land whose king is noble of birth and whose princes eat at a proper time for strength and not for drunkenness. Through laziness the rafters sag, because of idle hands the house leaks. A feast is made for laughter, wine makes life merry, and money is the answer for everything. Do not revile the king even in your thoughts, or curse the rich in your bedroom, because a bird in the sky may carry your words, and a bird on the wing may report what you say. Saying, watch your mouth. Chapter 11. Ship your grain across the sea. After many days, you may receive a return. Invest in 7 ventures. Yes, in 8. You do not know what disaster may come upon the land. Saying, diversify your investments, just in case. If clouds are full of water, they pour rain on the earth. Whether a tree falls to the south or to the north, in the place where it falls, there it's going to lie. Whoever watches the wind will not plant. Whoever looks at the clouds will not reap. As you don't know the path of the wind, or how the body is formed in a mother's womb, so you cannot understand the work of God, the maker of all things. Sow your seed in the morning, and at evening let your hands be not idle, for you don't know which will succeed, whether this or that, and whether both will do equally well. Then he comes to this section, which is entitled, Remember Your Creator While Young. He says, light is sweet, and it pleases the eyes to see the sun. However, many years anyone may live, let them enjoy them all. But let them remember the days of darkness, for there will be many. Everything to come is meaningless. You who are young, be happy while you're young. And let your heart give you the joy in the days of your youth. I've got to tell you, and I'll repeat this again. When my daughters, who are now 28, my twin daughters, they came to me back in 2014, 6 years ago. They were 22 years old and said, Dad, we have a great opportunity to move our business. They make the mermaid tails. To move that to Hawaii. And, but mom is discouraging us. And so, no, that's my ex-wife. It's another story. And they were really confused about what they should do. And this is where, for one of the first major times in their life, I used what I have called my mantra, that quote of Mark Twain's. I said to my daughters, I said, you're 22 years old. I said, 20 years from now, you'll regret more the things you didn't do than the things you did do. So cast off from the safe harbor. Set your sails to the trade winds. Explore, dream, discover. I said, you're 22 years old, and you have this opportunity. Take it, grasp it. Make the most of it before life sets in and you don't have the ability to do these things anymore. When you become married, when you become parents of children, when are you going to have opportunities to pack up and move to somewhere else? Like that, life starts to bring constraints as you get older. I said, so while you're young, experience this, love it, enjoy it. And that's exactly what they did. If you've ever seen that picture, if you go to my website, scottallenroberts.com, go to the About link, which tells you all about me. It's got my bio and my junk on there and all the pictures and stuff. There's a picture of me, my face with my two daughters kissing me on either cheek. This was a couple of days before they left for Hawaii when that picture was taken. And I'm looking up and I've got kind of a sad face. They're kissing me on each cheek from the sides. And that was right after we had this conversation, when we were sitting and talking about these things. And so their lives, they're now 28. They're back in the States, stateside, I should say. And they had a wonderful time in Hawaii. They just learned, while it was wonderful and exciting and exotic and paradisical, that at the same time, it was much more expensive to live there. So they moved the business back home. But they had the experience. So, however many years anyone may live, let them enjoy them all. But let them remember the days of darkness, for there will be many. Everything to come is meaningless. You who are young, be happy while you're young, and let your heart give you joy in the days of your youth. Follow the ways of your heart, and whatever your eyes see, but know that for all these things God will bring you into judgment. So then banish anxiety from your heart. Cast off the troubles of your body, for youth and vigor are meaningless. And then comes chapter 12, a very famous chapter of the book of Ecclesiastes, where Solomon starts to wrap this up. He says, "Remember your Creator in the days of your youth, before the days of trouble come, and the years approach when you'll say, 'I find no pleasure in them.' Before the sun and the light, and the moon and the stars grow dark, and the clouds return after the rain, when the keepers of the house tremble, and the strong men stoop, when the grinders cease because they are few, and those looking through the windows grow dim." By the way, back this up a little bit. He's using very poetic language to tell of what happens to your body as you grow old. He says, remember your Creator in the days of your youth, before the evil days come, the days of trouble come, and the years approach when you'll say, "I find no pleasure in them." Before the sun and the light and the moon and the stars grow dark, and the clouds return after the rain, when the keepers of the house tremble, and the strong men stoop. He's saying light grows dim in your eyes as you grow older. The keepers of the house, your body, your bones, your muscles grow, they tremble more. And the strong men stoop. The man who was once strong of body, the woman who was, we stoop. We lose that bodily structure, starts to decay. He says, when the grinders, your molars, cease because they are few, and those looking through the windows, the mind behind your eyes, grow dim. When the doors to the street are closed, and the sound of grinding fades. When people rise up at the sound of birds, but all their songs grow faint. The older we get, the earlier we rise, just by nature. I'm starting to feel some of that. But the bird song, we rise with the birds, but the song grows faint. Because we start to lose our hearing. When people are afraid of heights and of dangers in the streets. When the almond tree blossoms and the grasshopper drags itself along and desire is no longer stirred. Libido dies. Then people go to their eternal home and mourners go about the streets. Remember him before the silver cord is severed and the golden bowl is broken, before the pitcher is shattered at the spring and the wheel is broken at the well and the dust returns to the ground it came from and the spirit returns to God who gave it. Meaningless, meaningless, says the teacher. Everything is meaningless. And then he comes to the conclusion of the matter. Not only was the teacher wise, but he also imparted knowledge to the people. He pondered, and he searched out, and he set in order many proverbs. Remember, Solomon wrote the book of Proverbs. The teacher searched to find just the right words, and what he wrote was upright and true. The words of the wise are like goads, their collected sayings like firmly embedded nails given by one shepherd. Be warned, my son, of anything in addition to them. Of making many books there is no end, and much study wearies the body. Now, all has been heard. Here is the conclusion of the matter. Fear God and keep his commandments, for this is the duty of all mankind. For God will bring every deed into judgment, including every hidden thing, whether it is good or whether it is evil. And that's the end of Solomon's Book of Ecclesiastes. So what do you think of this? What do you think of the man Solomon after reading that? The man who, at least according to Bible stories and according to legends, was the richest, wealthiest, most wise man on the earth of his day. Someone who was committed as king to his people, Israel. Someone who was so prosperous and reigned in such a time of peace that his father David the warrior had established for him. He enters into this great time of peace and he spends a lifetime exploring. There's a place, remember, in here where he said, there's not a thing that I withheld from my hands. Not a thing that I could have that I did not own. And he took this time to explore. He explored beyond the faith of his fathers. He was responsible for bringing all sorts of pagan worship into the land of Israel. This was his day. This is what it was. Solomon lived the kind of life we all live. We may say we were born into this or born into that. This is the faith of my fathers, the joyful faith of my mother. I've taken those on, but we've moved into our own direction. As Solomon said in the Proverbs, he said, the wise person surrounds themselves with a great multitude of counselors. But in the end, the decision is left on his table alone. So this is what we do with life. We're brought into life and we have all these things that are given to us, all these choices, but we have choices to make. What are we going to believe? How are we going to act? How are we going to carry out and conduct our lives? Solomon says here, remember your Creator in the days of your youth, before the days of trouble come. In the King James, it says, before the evil days beset us. And the years approach when you'll say, I find no pleasure in them. And he talks and he goes through all these things about the body, these metaphors for the body that starts to decay as we get older. I look at myself, I'm 59, pushing 60. Because I haven't exercised every day of my life and kept fit and trim and in shape and vigor, there are days where I wish I had, because it hurts to bend over and tie my shoe. It's like, oh my God, I don't know if I can do that again. That's when the keepers of the house tremble and the strong men stoop. And so tying your shoe shouldn't be a big effort. But then there's also times where you bend over to tie your shoe and your stomach is like folding a grapefruit or a watermelon. It's like, try to fold a watermelon. It's like, oh my God, where did that come from? And so, you know, and so we work at that. We're constantly working at that. We're trying to retain our youth. And because we're losing it, because it goes away oh so quickly. And remember, after all of this, when he's saying, remember God, he's saying, remember him before the silver cord is severed. That's Greek mythology. Before the golden bowl is broken. That's Asian. Those philosophies. Before the pitcher is shattered at the spring and the wheel broken at the well and the dust returns to the ground it came from. And the spirit returns to God who gave it. And then after all of that, he says, and it's with exclamation points in the text, meaningless, meaningless, says the teacher. Everything is meaningless and a chasing after the wind. So I think that these are the words of a man who experienced life to its fullest, probably in aspects maybe more than you and I will ever experience life, because he had the means to do so. And yet he comes to the end of his days, and he says everything was meaningless, except that which was dedicated to living life. Now, I don't get preachy. I'm not trying to do that. But before we dig more in future days here into Solomon, his historical life, because we're going to take some time and establish the history of Solomon and some of the apologetics surrounding him. We're also going to look at more of the mysticism around him, the sacred ring, not sacred, the mystical, magical ring of Solomon. We're going to look at that as well. It's good to get a look at what the man was really like and what he had to say about life. And now you have it. I would encourage you, for nothing else than the sake of reading incredibly written ancient literature, 3,000 years ago, he wrote these things. It might be good to familiarize yourself with it. Take it and read the book. You can see by these two shows, you can read the whole book of Ecclesiastes in under an hour. And there's some interesting stuff there, and you'll find it. And we'll talk more about these things as the days go on. So, I hope you enjoyed this. Thanks for being here. We're going to be back on Monday, because today is Friday. Remember, not yesterday. And be sure to tune in on Sunday morning at 9 a.m. Central, 10 a.m. Eastern, and 7 a.m. California time, West Coast time. So come on in, join us for It's Sunday. We'll have a good talk, a live talk together in the chat room. Thanks for being here. Have a good weekend. We'll see you then. Dust in the wind. All they are is dust in the wind. Same old song. Just a drop of water in an endless sea. All we do crumbles to the ground, though we refuse to see. Dust in the wind. All we are is dust in the wind. Dust in the wind.